you for joining us here on the Neutral Zone. I am Phil Milani, joined as always by my esteemed colleague, my partner in crime. Really, the best way to describe this person is my everything. When I think about an everything, it's this person, and it's at Eric DeLalla.
Phil, good to be with you again.
It is very nice to be with you. You got your pink shirt on today.
Yeah.
Summertime.
I like your blue shirt.
Blue?
I think you wore something like that last week.
It's pastel July is what we sort of call it.
I like that.
Thank you very much.
Is that a pastel?
Yeah, this is pastel. This is a light blue.
Mm.
I think that's what pastel means. But we can ask the expert.
Ben Swanson
is here.
Wow, what an intro. That was great.
Yeah, is that true? Is that a pastel?
Pastel gray.
Pastel. That's like sort of a charcoal gray. That's like dark gray.
This is a pastel gray.
I think that if pastel, I think if you just have color and add white to it, mix it a little bit pastel.
Mm.
I don't know.
Our friend Eddie.
Eddie Pascal.
According to Wikipedia, yeah. they belong to a pale family of colors, high value, low saturation.
Wow, so pastel. Yeah.
Anyway, I have a question.
Oh,
Eric is your everything. Am I nothing?
No, it doesn't have to be the inverse. You know what I mean? You could be everything too.
I don't think
that makes sense. It's a zero sum game out here.
Oh, got it. I guess then, yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I don't know what else
I'll
to say.
Exit.
And everything. No, it's important to have you here, Swanson. I mean, you got to keep us on track. You got to keep
That's
it
why
fact
I'm
check.
Every,
you know, you got your laptop
episode.
Here. It's good to go, you know.
Yeah.
What are you watching over there?
Sure.
I got Netflix on
over
here.
Yeah, you got Netflix
here.
Going.
Not a sponsor.
Not a sponsor.
Oh,
could be.
Peacock?
If it wanted.
No, not a sponsor either.
I think you could be listening to Prime or watching Prime.
Nope, I wouldn't do that either.
Hulu, maybe?
No, not Prime. No, God, no.
Maybe just some DenverBroncos.com content.
Yeah, DenverBroncos.com.
That's true, not Prime.
I'll watch maybe like a documentary series or something.
Oh, got it.
Yeah.
On DenverBroncos.com?
Yeah.
Okay, nice.
Perfect.
Nice. All right, well, our topics today are offensive and defensive player of the year.
Love it.
We'll look into the crystal ball. And we'll make some projections because
the Brandon crystal ball,
exactly.
Mario crystal ball.
You know, this is prediction time of year. You know, we're a couple weeks out from training camp, so we gotta just sort of make some bold.
Yeah, what's today?
Let's take some
chances.
It's
the 13th, right?
Make some content.
This is the 13th today, a Thursday.
Thursday
here
the 13th,
in the middle of July. Yeah, I think we're 2 weeks away from the start of.
Can't wait.
So we're going to make some bold predictions, offense and defensive player of the year for the Broncos.
Perfect.
You ready?
Yeah, let's do it.
Which one should we start with first? Because you're sort of saying one side of the ball is more important than the other.
Yeah, I think people just tend to start with offense.
Oh, really? Because it's more important.
So let's start with defense.
What do you want to do?
Defense.
Okay.
This is less exciting, I think,
we're
right?
For a loop.
You got to stick around for the offense.
Yeah.
Coming up.
On the neutral zone.
Okay, who's going to be your defensive player of the year for the Broncos?
I think it's Pat.
Really? Wow. How'd you come up with that?
Yeah, well, I had this big spreadsheet in the office and kind of all sorts
advanced analytics?
Yep. All
EVOA.
Sorts,
EVOA.
All sorts
everywhere.
Of numbers and
charts.
Time of year and their age and what moon was in, what are they, rising and all that.
Waning?
The horoscopes. Yep.
Waxing.
Watson, you?
Yep. You were looking at the constellations up there?
And,
Big Dipper?
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah. Get the guac out. You're a Big Dipper. Yeah, I looked at all
the
that.
Scoop? You do the scoop chips or no?
I love a nice scoop chip.
I do too.
But yeah, I looked at all that, Phil, and I Pat Sertan the second.
Really?
Again.
It's kind of like, you know, those charts and then they have like all the advanced and it has like their little picture.
Yep.
And then all the way over in the corner, that's like where Jokic was. But for the Broncos, that's where Sertan is.
Yeah. And that's not to disrespect Justin Simmons, who obviously
it sounds like a little bit of disrespect. But
well, when you did that, it sounded like it. I said I went through a long process. Justin Simmons obviously
really
tied for the league lead in interceptions last year. Randy Gregory, we know the type of talent he has. They bring in Zach Allen, a lot of good players to choose from. But Pat Sertan, I think one is at a position where he can do that again.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's repeatable. It's not a guy who had 10 sacks 1 year and now has to try to do it again, which can be difficult because sacks can be a difficult stat to kind of you can have really good rushes sometimes and not get those numbers. Pat did all this with just two or three interceptions and still was a first-team All-Pro, still shut guys down. I have a really hard time imagining that he's just going to drop off.
Like, there was nothing lucky about his season last year. It's not like...
If anything, there was some unluckiness that he didn't end up with more interceptions.
Yeah, it's like sometimes with the interceptions, I feel like, hey, the ball's coming your way a lot. It's bouncing around, you know, and you're just catching them.
Yeah.
Sometimes, like, they just, like, fall right into your lap.
Fall right to you.
Easy ones.
Yeah. Easy.
Sometimes there's, like, nobody even around you, and it's like, boom, interception. Sometimes that happens.
Yep.
That did not happen for Surtain last year.
No.
You know, he just played really solid coverage.
And I think also a big part of earning honors, like first-team All-Pro, Pro Bowl...
The ball gets rolling.
The reputation that you have to build... And now everyone's going to look at Pat Surtain as, hey, he's a first-team All-Pro. He's a Pro Bowler. He's going to have to do something. Like, if he just keeps playing the way he played, he's going to get it again.
Kind of like the Vaughn.
Exactly.
You know, once Vaughn went up to that level.
Once you get there, you just got to kind of maintain the standard. He doesn't have to do anything crazy and have 8 interceptions.
Yeah.
If he has another 2 to 3 and plays as well as he did and plays well in primetime a couple of times, that's going to be good enough. And, you know... Justin and Randy, both really good football players, but Pat Surtain is a Hall of Fame talent.
He is. And he can be that.
He can be, yeah. Hall of Fame talent. That doesn't mean he's going
to
end up there.
Oh, but, that's a nice way to
but
say
he's,
it.
Well, that's why I said the first time. You just didn't listen.
Yeah, so you think he's going to be a Hall of Famer. Got it.
And so when you look at a guy like that, it's like having a champ on your team, where every year you just expect Champ Bailey to be the best guy on the defense, and... Until I'm proven otherwise, we talk about that a lot, right? Like, prove this to me before I expect it. For Pat now, he's in the category where until I see otherwise, I'm going to assume he's the best player on this defense, one of the best players in the league, has a chance to be defensive player of the year if he gets some of those interceptions up. I mean, it just, everything kind of slants in his favor.
Now, the Broncos defense was good last year.
Yeah.
So, like, that did help him. But there weren't significant drop-offs or anything this offseason on that side. So you would expect... the defense to be good once again.
Well, you know, they did go 5-12, right? I mean, it wasn't like when you win football games, you tend to get overvalued. Surtain did this on a bad football team or a team that didn't have a lot of success.
Yeah.
And so...
But that side of the ball was good.
Right. But still, like, a lot of the times they were in prime time, it became a joke.
Yeah.
You know, and so if you do go... Say you win 10 games or something like that, and Pat plays at the same level.
You're more noticed.
Now you that helps even more.
More taught.
So if you're able to stand out on a bad football team, that speaks to the type of player you are.
Yeah. But I was just saying, like, the secondary is the same. It's still be good.
But they
like,
were good because of him in part, right?
They probably have both. Probably a little bit of both. You know, like, Justin's there. That helps him. Damari stepped up, played really well. Ronald Darby was good when he was healthy.
But if you
start.
Replace Pat with an average football player, I'm not sure
not
it looks the same.
Yeah, of course. But I'm saying that surrounding cast should be good once again, which means that we're expecting another good year for Surtain coming up. I like
Absolutely.
That. I'm going to go with Randy Gregory, I think, just because I'm sort of riding that train. I'm on the Randy train, and I think that sometimes when you're really good, like, say, like a champ or, like, here's like a nice point that you like to make sometimes. You're like, LeBron James should win MVP every year. You kind of think that. You know what I mean? And then, but they have to give it to other people.
Didn't
once
he retire?
In a while. LeBron James? I don't think so.
No.
Did he?
I don't know.
Oh, maybe I missed it. I don't know. Maybe Pat Surtain is just so good that, like, if another guy has a really good year, you're like, oh, he's the defensive player of the year. You know what I mean? Like, he's just, Pat is greatness. But if some other guy is, like, really good, you're like, oh, he's the defensive player of the year, because you could just give it to Pat every year.
So your argument for someone else being defensive player of the year is that Pat is too good.
He's just good, and you just expected that. Like, for example,
so
like
why
if Randy
didn't get to third.
Exactly. It's the same thing with Jokic. Like, you just expect the greatness there. They're like, let's just give it to somebody who's never won it.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean? Let's just do that. Whatever. Sort of what they did, you know? So I think that, like, if Randy goes out there and has, like, a really good year, double-digit sacks, he's healthy, he's out there, then you're like, that was really good from Randy. He's the Broncos Defensive Player of the Year. And that's what I'm envisioning from him. Double-digit sacks, hopefully healthy the whole season, making a real impact. The thing about Randy is his sack numbers have never really been high, but he's always making plays. Yep. He's got those really, really long arms. Gets his hands on footballs, you know, makes plays, a lot of strips and a lot of recoveries, and that's sort of his game. And I think when you talk about getting recognized, you got to make those game-changing plays, not just a normal sack, but you got to turn the ball over, you got to make a big play. And I think that's going to happen a lot for Randy this year. And when you go back and look at the end of the year, you're going to be like, Pat was really good. He was that lockdown guy, but Randy was out there making those huge game-changing plays. Mm. And so I think he's going to be the Broncos Defensive Player of the Year.
Okay.
Plus, for all the reasons we've already always talked about, I think the offense is going to be better, which is going to help everybody on defense.
Oh, so now you're just going to repeat what Ben Swanson said last week.
Yeah.
Wow.
Which is, and I repeated what Phil said the previous week. So.
Yeah.
Swanson, I was trying to help you there.
Swanson, who is your Defensive Player of the Year?
I mean, it has to be Pat, but for the sake of conversation, I think there is
a lot to be said
about just the value of creating turnovers. And Justin Simmons reliably does this every season.
Yeah, they come his
way. He's had five picks like each of the past 5 years, something like that.
It's a good stat.
If it's
true. That is a nice stat.
What about the horoscope?
He's the only player, right, to have that many?
Ever.
But, I mean, whether you want to say like his interceptions are maybe not as difficult as Pat's are. Like,
yeah.
Like Pat's diving pick against Mahomes last year.
That's true.
Incredible. But Justin just has a knack for the ball. He can, you know, track it well. And
does he have a knack for the ball or does the ball have a knack for him?
I don't know.
They're friends.
Frank Clark?
They're friends. Frank. He could be in the mix.
You think he steals any sacks from Randy?
It's possible. It's possible. They're going to have to help each other out.
Mm,
yeah, maybe he steals a few. Maybe Nick Bedito. You know, he takes that jump.
A little jumpy?
He comes back huge from the offseason. You know
possible.
What I mean? Yeah. He drinks a lot of protein shakes, and he does a lot of heavy back squats.
It'll get him there.
And it'll get him there. But I do think that Justin Simmons is also
good choice.
That's a solid choice.
Also, fact check, I was wrong. Five interceptions each of the past three seasons.
Swanson, never admit when you're wrong.
He had six last year.
He had six last year. He's averaging five a year over the past 4 years. So.
Oh, sir.
Still wrong.
Makes you think.
Makes you think a lot.
Makes you think.
Yeah. All right, offense?
Yeah, let's switch to the other side of the ball. Offense, you want me to go first here?
Sure.
I think Jerry Jeudy's going to be the...
Ooh.
I mean, we talked a lot about this over the last month or so here, but just the way that Sean Payton likes to use guys where he has a mismatch with, he has an advantage there. I think Jerry's going to be that guy for this offense. He really came on at the end of last season. I think that that's a little bit of a sign of, hey, I'm figuring some stuff out here. I'm understanding how I can have success in this league. And the other thing is that I think that Jerry looks at that draft class with the other wide receivers he came in, and he knows that he's in that category of a CeeDee Lamb, a Justin Jefferson. The talent is there. The production has not been. And so I think that this is time for Jerry. This is his year where it's time to just really come onto the scene, become that national name, become the guy that the Broncos – thought they were getting with the 15th overall pick. Like, it's time for him to become that dude. And I think Sean Payton's going to help him get there. And I think I'm expecting big things from Jerry.
Yeah, I don't. So. It's got to be Jerry. Sorry to.
All right. And you've been listening to.
I considered Russ. But I think the way the Broncos want to play football in terms of running the ball and.
It's hard going second, huh?
Yeah, difficult.
Yeah.
I don't think he's going to get the – like, I think for him to be offensive player of the year, you need him to be up in the 35-plus touchdowns. Yeah, and I just don't know if he's going to get there. It certainly could, but I think it's more likely he's in the 30 to 35.
Putting that ceiling on him there?
So you can smash through it.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Okay, I like that.
And I thought, oh, okay, well, there's so many receiving options between a Greg Dulcich and a Dulcich and a Sutton and a Tim Patrick that maybe Jerry's numbers don't get to where they could be. But, just from what we've seen during OTAs and minicamp, hearing Sean Payton talk about Jerry Jeudy, seeing the way Jerry ended last year, like you mentioned, Phil, his talent is just so unique, and I think Sean's going to find a way to get the most out of him, and he should have, 1,200 yards, 10-plus touchdowns. I mean, this is a guy that, because what, he had 6 last year, I think?
Yeah.
This should be a big step for Jerry Jeudy and put him in kind of that top 10 receivers in the league conversation. As long as he stays healthy,
knock on wood,
which has been an issue at times. I think you're right. People are going to look at Jerry nationally as kind of that breakout guy.
Yeah.
And, we could pick a Greg Dulcich or a Russ for the sake of argument, but I think it's pretty clearly Jerry.
And I would say that those other guys could take some numbers away from him, but that doesn't tend to happen so much in Sean Payton's offenses.
Like, right. Yep.
He does tend to get the ball to...
There's one or two guys.
Yeah, exactly. So it does seem like he likes to find that mismatch with a guy and then really go to town with it, and make... Really, really make a guy like Jerry Jeudy give opposing coaches nightmares. What are we going to do with this guy? I think that he tends to do that with his playmakers. And so Jerry's a guy where once he gets his hands on him, once he really understands how he gets that separation, how he's a weapon, he's really going to exploit that. So
no, I do think Greg is probably the second option there, but it just we haven't seen it, and I always like to go based off what I've seen where there's a little bit of evidence. Greg could easily have a really big season because of how Sean Payton wants to use him, but he didn't play all that much last year. There were some games where he was really great and then some games where it kind of didn't do as much, so it's just hard to put him above Jerry based on the fact that we haven't seen it at the same level, whereas Jerry can go out and put up 150 yards in a game.
Yep.
We haven't seen that yet from Greg.
But what was it that Sean Payton said at the owners' meetings? He was like, when I watched that tape from last year, it's really hard to sort of identify what's going on. So
he said, if you're asking if I'm criticizing the offense and special teams, I am.
Yeah. He does. Yeah, that was nice. I was like, yeah! So who knows? Maybe what we saw last year, too, is like not even a reality.
Whoa.
Like Greg could just be the.
Maybe Jerry's not good. Is that what you're saying?
No, I was sort of saying the other way around.
Okay.
Like some of the guys who didn't have those big years last year.
They'll be good. But the people who were good, stay good.
Stay good.
Perfect.
Funny how I see it that way. I'm looking through some glasses.
Yeah.
Swanson?
I'm going to go with Russ. He's the thing that makes it all go. And if Jeudy is playing that well, I trust in Sean to optimize offense for Russ as well. And if he's doing that, Russ will be playing well like we saw at the end of the season. As you just said, who knows, but...
That's true.
Rosberg.
He's
the most out of these guys.
Yeah, I think he'll bounce back. And if he's making the offense, an efficient kind of machine, then...
Get it humming
a little. He'll be the guy making the team go.
Yeah. I do think that's also possible. Russ, what he did with Drew Brees. I mean, obviously Drew Brees is a unique talent, but he got some huge numbers out of Drew.
Russ is a unique talent too.
Yeah.
He does, that throw to Jerry at the end of last year, very few guys can make that throw.
Yeah.
Russ made it rolling to his non-dominant side.
That's true.
It was really impressive.
Yeah.
I wish that we knew what Javonte was going to be from a health perspective.
I do think that this team is going to try to run the ball a lot.
Because if, you talk about, Sean's philosophy. He has had a lot of the times kind of this bell cow type guy.
Yeah.
And not always, but on occasion. And if Javonte were coming in fully healthy, and we just don't know what that looks like right now.
Yeah.
You could see him getting a chance to carry the ball 15 times a game, 20 times a game, and then get some plays out of the backfield.
Totally.
And he's got the skill set, I think, to run after the catch. So he's a guy that I'm just interested in seeing, because I think he could, if he's healthy, put up big numbers.
I mean, it's easy to forget, but like last year, there was so much attention on Russ coming into the season, but there was also a lot on Javonte Williams about how he was about to, that second year, he was going to take that huge leap.
Yeah.
You know, he was a big fantasy name, you know, going into the year. Like, he's going to have a lot of touchdowns, you know, this kind of thing. And the injury sort of just skews everything a little bit. But last year, he was going to have this huge year. That was the talk, at least.
So, right, yeah, absolutely.
He could easily get back to that if he's healthy and in a scheme that really, and behind a better offensive line, you know. I do think that Javonte, if he's healthy, he could do some damage.
Yep.
Put up some points.
Put the ball in the box.
CJ liked to do that. He liked to do that. So you put the ball in the box, good things happen.
Points.
Yeah. Eric, any shout-outs you'd like to get to here?
Doing shout-outs.
Well, I mean, I think it would be wrong not to mention Liz Gerald.
You're right. Shout-out to her.
I think we just say it. Shout-out there.
Shout-out to her.
Yeah. And shout-out to the month of July. You know, it's a nice month in the football calendar.
Yeah.
Really the only month where, like, just not really anything's on the calendar for the football, for the NFL.
Shout-out to months.
It's a nice month. I mean, I like the month.
One of the best. So, top 12.
Yeah. Well, but, like, if you were to rank months a little bit.
Oh, boy. Oh, Lord. This is how its would own you, podcast.
How would you, where would July fall for you?
I mean.
Well, first of all, what's your favorite month? Just say it. Just tell me what's your favorite month.
I like a nice April.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
A lot of rain in April a lot of times.
Well, you get the springtime weather.
April showers.
Yeah, but it's starting to May be flowers. Warm out. You have the Masters.
Oh.
It's my birthday.
Now it comes out. So April is your, that's right. Got it.
A little bias.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but it's my bias. Favorite month. Yeah. That's right.
That is bias. Yeah, the whole bias. Thing is bias.
Yeah.
So we're talking unbiased.
And works. Then I think after that, I'd probably pick like September maybe.
Really?
I like that's a nice. Like a September football starts.
Yeah.
By that time, you're kind of tired of the heat, and you're like, I'm ready for a little bit of crisp fall air.
Yeah.
Get that. Maybe toward the end of the month, the leaves start to change.
You could just go straight to October then and be like, the leaves have changed.
Yeah, October is a good football month.
Nice, yeah, I like October.
October is nice.
Yeah. I do like October. October's I will come good. Clean. I'll say July. That's when my birthday is, too. Clean. So I like. I also like July because it's my birthday. Yeah.
Harry Potter's birthday is that month, too.
I know, yeah. That's what I'm saying. It's a great month. So, Anson, your favorite month?
Yeah.
I mean, just chime in here.
I think June is really nice.
Oh.
June's pretty nice.
June is nice.
I like May, which my birthday.
Birthday, month. Yeah.
This is really just turning into everybody when's telling your birthday? You, what's your birthday? Why do you like that month the best?
Yeah, but I think June's maybe a little bit better weather-wise as far as, like, you know, not as rainy.
Just how many months days. Start with fireworks? How many months start with fireworks? Just the one.
Yeah, it didn't rain in Denver at all
January?
In June. You're right.
January literally right. starts with fireworks.
Or you could say December and, oh, no, it is the start of June. Yeah, that's true. Okay, fine. 2 months start with fireworks. But January's cold, so I go to July. Boom.
All right.
Yeah, so shout out to July, April, and also
October.
You hedged a little bit.
I'm going to say June.
June.
June's nice.
June. Those are our favorite months. Shout out. All right, that's going to do it for us. For Ben Swanson and Eric Law, I am Phil Milani. You've been listening to
The Neutral Zone. Oh,